Thank you.
We'll go to Babka in London, England, on the independent line.
Hi, I'm Babak. I'm calling from London. I was introduced to C-SPAN through BBC News Broadcasting 20 years ago, and unfortunately they stopped a few years ago. I hope BBC will reconsider their decision and start broadcasting C-SPAN again, because U.S. is an important ally and we should know more about U.S. politics and their attitude about world affairs. So that's first I wanted to say. Secondly, to your guest, Mr. Bowman, I just wanted to say that when you are dealing with a religious regime like Iran who believes in self-destruction, we have to accept that deterrence does not work. And we keep getting Western politicians applying Western solutions to Middle Eastern problems. In the Middle East, in order for any deterrence to have an impact, the proportionality factor has to be at least 3 times of any attack. And unfortunately, on this occasion, Israel's response to Iran attack was too little, and this will have a negative, it would have almost no impact on the Iranian attitude. And I wish the Western politician would think again how to advise their allies in the Middle East.
Thank you for the call. A lot of significant points there. I'll try to address a few of them very quickly. If you're saying that the regime in Iran is not your average nation state, I would completely agree with you. I would say that this is a radical regime posing as a nation state. And that's one of the fundamental flaws with a lot of the policies emanating from Washington, and respectfully, I think, often from the Biden administration, is that they I worked in the U.S. Senate for 9 years. I had the opportunity to see then-Senator Biden in action, doing the best he could. But, you know, when you work that long in the Senate Foreign Relations Committee, I think there's sometimes a tendency to view many things, everything, through the nation-state lens, and that has some value. But the bottom line is that this is a radical regime that is the fundamental threat to regional security. And that's one of the reasons why you had the Abraham Accords a few years ago. You had Bahrain and the United Arab Emirates finally admitting publicly what many Arab governments had said for a long time, and that Iran was the threat to regional security, not Israel. So I agree, you got to start with an accurate diagnosis of your adversary to get effective prescriptions. And an accurate diagnosis for me suggests that this Iran oppresses and brutalizes its own people. And the more revenue it makes, the more it's going to export terrorism and build on its largest missile arsenal in the world. And as we saw a few days ago, this is not for show. This is for the purpose of killing and attacking Israel, and also, of course, attacking U.S. forces, which we've seen over and over again. Your point on deterrence, you know, I won't bore the viewers. I'm going giving an hour lecture on deterrence. But the bottom line is this: deterrence is in the mind of the adversary. It's their perception. Not mine or yours or Washington's or Israel's. It's what they think about our political will and our military capability to prevent them from accomplishing their objective, and whether our response will make them regret it in the first place. And so that's a perception of will, political will and military capability. I think what Israel demonstrated was a military capability to do much more and to do it effectively and precisely, and while also being restrained. It's a bit like, I would say, the Iranian attack on Israel is, I don't mean to be provocative with this, but if you like metaphors, the Iranian attack on Israel is a bit like a kind of a crazy, misbehaving, out-of-control child lashing out ineffectively, and the Israeli response was a competent, calm, confident adult spanking that child.